Oh, hello. Still doing this, huh? Well, I guess I'm glad to know that I never get tired of projecting my opinion onto other people.
Another year, another beer, am I right? Woohoo! What another wacky journey into, oh, the humanity and the world is ending. What a silly world we live in.
Who cares? That's what we've got pop music for.
And golly gee, was it the perfect way for us to avoid our reality. It allowed us to be sad. The world went up in arms and a worthless white rapper who makes my home city look worse challenged some former old white dude out of nowhere. The Billboard Hot 100 did more than ever to display songs that I would never hear, which makes total sense for songs that are the most popular of the year.
And the least intuitive part? This has been the most static year of pop music I've ever followed.
You really liked the songs we received this year? Then you had a highly enjoyable year. At a quick glance, 17 songs hung around in the top 40 for at least 6 months. Radio hit a wall. I get to be subjected to the same old songs all year.
If radio is any indication, Shape of You must still be in the top 20.
Overall, I'd call 2018 a weak year. There just wasn't a lot to glom onto. It's the opposite of 2013. 2013 had a ton of amazing songs and a ton of actual garbage songs. This year had some good and some bad, but not a lot of differentiation or quality. 2018 was less of a year than most.
But could I feel 10? Damn, Skippy.
I'd actually call it more solid than what I came up with halfway through the year. I was able to jettison those songs with a mildly annoying thing and replace it with some actual crap.
Nothing makes for a better list than passionate anger.
These are my only rules. They will most likely never change, therefore I'm done showing them forever.
See? Told ya.
Let's give this weak shit a proper burial. We're counting down! I'm upset. The top 10 worst songs of 2018, God, I hope this gets as many views as last year's. Number 10. For the first time this summer, my So Far fell under a format. One group of songs were barely hateable, while the others just made me frustrated on stagnant artist production.
Spoilers, I still am.
Although half a year is a lot of time to knock a list around, one frustrating thing per song category couldn't completely duck out of the final list.
Our poor ears. It's you, babe. No, that's not why this is here. We're not gonna listen to the part that makes this good.
Nicotine. I already hate smoking, Camilla. You don't have to make unhealthy addiction sound even uglier than it is. This may actually be the best anti-smoking ad possible. Nicotine. Heroin. Morphine. For 15 seconds, it's the poorest attempt at putting elation into singing. I don't know what it feels like to scrape your eardrums with sandpaper, but I'm pretty sure this is what it would sound like.
Oh, okay. Well, I've heard worse explanations for it.
Yeah, like a monster. She's willingly attacking us with her least usable singing possible. God damn, Camilla.
And this song could have been perfectly ignorable.
Everything else about it is not bad. Its production is totally fine. Camilla is believable in delivery most of the time. Never Be the Same could have just been another fairly okay song to be all over radio, like Boom Clap or Bad at Love. Instead, hearing even a second of it makes me run for the hills.
And do I have more to say about it? Nope. I'm
upset. Number 9.
I know I'd go back to you. Why would anybody ask for more of this?
Selena Gomez, why do we keep letting this happen? We are years separated from her demographic buying her properties because they share her age. We're still doing the same old shit. Song after unlikable song of a Disney kid utilizing her least marketable talent.
Well, least aesthetically marketable.
Based on lyrical content alone, Back to You will not be making this list. It would have a better shot at making the next video if Selena Gomez didn't suck so hard.
Take away lyrics, and what do you got? I've been running
through the jungle, I've been running with the wolves. If you want this to be straightforward, it's a second attempt at It Ain't Me with polar opposite results. It has 8 songs worse than it.
Well, that was easy. I'm
upset. Number? Now, a failed redo is more intricate of a failure than an instant write-off. Clearly something quantifiable went wrong.
Do you see the difference?
From my understanding, Kygo making a smash pop hit was a bit of a fluke. The man prides himself on artistic integrity and quality. His one shot was that. Maybe not good enough to be top 10 because it was too repetitive and was infested with a shitty singer, but I'd call him good based on this one entry.
If Wolves is any indicator, Marshmallow should probably stop trying pop hits.
This is really weak in terms of production, and it feels like a bad copy. Oh, nice guitar. You know, like this. Except there, it's concise and catching, instead of uninspired and bored to tears.
Or maybe prime you for the drop?
That's less interesting than the other elements. I don't know why Buckethead implied this would be the springboard that'd push him into the production ethos. I think Selena just took the first brash, unemployed producer she could find.
He was so embarrassed to make it, he won't even show his face.
Of course it isn't all his fault this sucks. He was used as an attempt to keep Selena's one good song in a row streak going by doing the exact same thing again. Clearly it's what Princess was going for. The choruses are supposed to get you singing along. The problem with It Ain't Me's chorus is it sounds good and it's fun to sing along with. So she put a stop to that real quick. I've been down the darkest alley, saw the dark side of the moon to get to you. Lightning did not strike twice. You can tell this was all forced.
Unlike Selena's ability to sing.
It's okay. She never had to work on that. She sounds like an angel. Or like my cat when she gets tired of being held. And more than half a decade, we sit and we endure these shitty Selena Gomez songs. And for what? The hope that a song has one good element and is inevitably held back by her inability to sing? Good riddance.
Selena, I know I'll run away from you. I'm upset.
50,000 Number 8.
Hey. Okay, fine. I don't hate it that much. I still hate it, though.
Being among one of the most overrated songs of the last 5 years, Havana is maestroed by Fifth Harmony secessionist Camila Cabello, whose solo career has been, well, existent? Her first breakaway gig came with Shawn Mendes, and she got to play the role of Selena Gomez, where she just about ruined somebody else's song by rubbing her stinky performance all over it. Yeah, I wouldn't like to completely like a Shawn Mendes song. Thanks, annoying lady. Then we have the big first solo hit, Crying in the Club.
There's really two options for this. You either hate it or think it's completely pointless.
Should she have reflected and maybe came crawling back? Nope, gotta completely fail on your own first. So what pandering subject matter should the biggest song of her career be about?
Cultural cash-in.
That right there is as far as the song goes into actually escaping the framework of I don't like this guy. Throw a few Spanish words here and there, anchor it with a player piano, and add one trumpet lick, and oh cool, your song is done. Number one, best song ever, no problems.
Look, watching Best List last year was somewhat difficult.
Critic after critic, relishing in parts of the song that either gave me the polar opposite reaction or barely there to begin with. Like the trumpet. It's so great, it gets thrown in at 2:36 after the song is already more than shit the bed.
Cause Camila, well, she's not Selena Gomez bad?
I mean, performance-wise, this is probably the least terrible of Camila's. But she's just kind of okay all over the song.
And that's as long as the lyrics aren't shit. Havana.
Oh, Camila, did nobody tell her? They renamed the capital of Cuba to Havana in 1968. It's not Havana Unana anymore.
Some schools really need to update their textbooks.
I don't ask too much, right? All I want is a chorus to be full of words, not na-nas and
do-do's.
It's fucking lazy is what it is.
And it only happens every time.
it doesn't matter, because that boy is from a different part of Cuba. East Atlanta,
And I'm supposed to be ashamed for disliking this.
I'm still the biggest purveyor of, if it sucks, throw it out. But again, I'm in the minority here, and this chorus is good enough, I guess.
May I present to you Mr. Good Enough, Young Thug.
Compliment after compliment to a guy nobody ever thought could reach any real career notoriety for this.
He actually does give a believable performance. As a disgruntled old man. Fresh out East Atlanta with no mountain down. I want her back in East Atlanta, goddammit!
Look, overall, Camilla really is fine. Young Thug is shit. But he sounds like an instrument. Like hell, he sounds like he needs a nap. Too busy stomping out flaming bags of garbage on his doorstep.
Literally, his verse is an old man bitching because he's staunch in his ways.
It's all a wine fest. I don't want to go to East Atlanta. You come to East Atlanta. It's pointless. This song is about a 2-minute argument over hometown pride. It's the equivalent of Packers and Bears fans shouting at each other. Havana, overrated AF. No more Camilla, please. I'm upset. Number 7.
Yep, still stuck on somebody we've already talked about. What a garbage year.
Ooh, spooky, it's a ghost. Oh wait, no, it's a hack with an EDM gimmick. Soulless, artistically absent, and wasting valuable radio time we could be giving to boring old John Mayer.
Whose existence is at least more fascinating than Marshmello's.
So what happens when you put two C-list pop artists together to make a song that will keep them embarrassingly relevant?
Haven't I made it obvious? Haven't I made it clear? Let me spell it out for you. F-R-I-N-D-S. Wonder what that stands for.
Maybe it's cool new slang. Sometimes I'm behind on the trends. Maybe it's an abbreviation like TARDIS. Friends. Reach in? No duh, son.
Obviously.
Wait, what's that subtitle? Oh, silly mistake. You guys meant to type friend zone. Friend zone anthem.
Wait. We're nothing more than friends. We're just friends. Oh, that isn't the title of the song. It's actually this.
I see where my confusion began. We don't know how to spell friends. Six spaces for vocal inputs, 7 letters. No matter how fast you attempt to throw that E in there, it's still gonna sound like the back end of an I. It's a vowel-on-vowel spelling conundrum. Usually we learn how to speak clearly and effectively when spelling.
Nah, that's not important. It's not like you'd put a spelling gimmick into your pop song as an adult.
But it makes sense. This is a pretty childish song, in the sense of hyperbole.
The only thing that could redeem this premise is if it was 1,000% true.
In terms of being a reasonable, believable human being, Anne Marie isn't trying even a little. Don't go look at me with
that look in your eye. You shall look at her in the way she deems fit, pervert. Again, if this isn't exaggerated, then her attitude is justified.
Instead, it's an onslaught of arrogance and this shitty attitude of how she's above your nonsense.
Therefore, Friends is a 2018 Meghan Trainor song.
No, no, no.
No, 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 indeed.
Oh yeah, I went there. Even Meg's garbage from this year is better than this, and that song judges your mom's parenting skills. Your mama raised
you better than that. I'd still take that over this.
We're just friends.
Condensed, there's no realistic circumstance where somebody would feel this justified to thrash another person because they want to date. And this title, like nobody would willingly stamp their name to something so repulsively dickish.
Plus there's Marshmello, of which there's nothing to say about, which is even worse.
Remember when he was supposed to be different? Remember that individualistic sound he brought to his songs?
Summer of 2018. I'm pronouncing him Zed.
Maybe Marshmello is Zed. How are we supposed to know? He probably tried the whole differentiating thing just to realize he's too much in love with himself and would rather stay average. So he made both acts lame. Fan theory.
Although he had to throw something in there to throw people off.
And I thought I hated New Jack Swing. 90s R&B whistle takes the cake. What an ugly reference, and what a hack, again.
And you're a hack, and you're a hack, and you're a hack.
Strong words from the hack copying Todd, but it's true. Friends, trash, through and through.
F-R-I-E-N-D-S. There you go. You can spell it. I'm upset.
Number six. Whatever
it takes. Welcome back, guys. See you next year, and every year forever.
Am I too hard on Imagine Dragons? No, that was a stupid question. All of that potential wasted for shouting and talking about how great they are.
I can pinpoint their death in another video slated for spring.
Whatever It Takes really wasn't all that bad in the end. It's definitely better than those first two singles.
Like, that was a hard feat to achieve. Hey guys, don't make something really annoying. It's better already.
So that leaves us with you, Natural. You are...
my favorite Imagine Dragons song of the last four. What, you think I don't hate Whatever It Takes? Whatever it takes!
Small, teeny tiny gripe out of the way first. The premise. Cause I love how it feels when I break the chains. Shut up. Every stupid ass single was this. We are great, we will succeed.
We fucking get it.
I just find it hilarious the one team that used this trash as a rally song got crushed. Now that's poetic justice at its finest.
Oh, Cleveland, my home, my giant river fire.
Honestly, it's not that big of a deal. I get how people see this as motivational. Whatever It Takes is really on here for one fucking atrocious thing.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dan Reynolds!
Falling too fast to prepare for this. Tripping in the world could be dangerous.
First impressions. This blows. More than the chipmunk voice of Thunder. More than the chorus of Believer. More than I Bet My Life's stompy, shouty chorus also.
Without a doubt, this rapping is the worst part of any Imagine Dragons song.
As non-PC as this can be, this is just so white. It's so rigid and emotionless. There's no harder artistic merit. But it's fast. Yeah, so is an auctioneer. And he doesn't get millions for doing his job. Hell, at least there's a purpose to what he's doing. Not I'm Dan Reynolds, a fucking raw talent.
My next point. This isn't art.
You know me, Captain Whitebread. Grew up in an area where rap culture couldn't be farther from me. My family was very anti-rap, but they mostly listen to country, so their opinion is invalid. It used to be that rap had no merit or artistic purpose. It wasn't music to them.
Of course they were completely wrong, but if they said the same thing about Dan, they'd be right.
Rappers can be very talented people and work really hard to get out there, but this dickweed car salesman just appropriates it into his garbage song for what? Does he think it sounds good? Does he think he's good at it? No. This is an artless time fill.
And maybe the most important of all, could it have been better? Easily.
It's not like they haven't made legitimate songs before this. If this song's verses were just standard to any other ID song, this would be the best thing they'd done in the last album. Instead, Dan Reynolds and his artistically preposterous brain chose the absolute worst thing to put in a song in the year 2018.
That's why you're a natural, not him. I'm upset.
Number 5.
Well, I don't want to wait. Let's get this the hell over with.
Another year, another Maroon 5 song. It's chock full of more continuous mistakes and floundering a decade after a group so far out of its prime needs to stop making effortless, pointless trash.
I'm sure I'm the only one still pissed about something so forgotten. It's what I do best.
First step is to identify what flavor of 5 we have today. Oh yeah, we already know this. It's a horribly uninteresting song musically. The only interesting thing is how badly it fails. When I first heard this, I thought my internal tempo measuring skills were shot. The guitar ran for 10 seconds longer, it'd be military-approved torture.
They call it tempo deprecation.
Good job, guys. Any other cool tricks? Man, how could I ever imply they're phoning it in at this point?
This is not annoying, it's just really damn good.
Have you heard this majestic chorus? First, Adam talks it out.
Wait, can you turn around? Can you turn around? Just wait. Wait, can we talk this out? Just wait.
Then he transitions so beautifully.
Cause I wanna be with you.
Did you hate the low effort? Now you get it annoyingly an octave higher. But it doesn't go up an octave after the second time, which would make the song funny, but that would be something, and Maroon 5 is past that phase of their lifespan.
Look, are you guys as burnt out listening to me talk about Maroon 5 as I am talking about Maroon 5?
It's like trying to ride a dead horse. Not only is it exceedingly pointless, we're not moving anytime soon. This act will always do the same flavors of crap because, well, it sells.
But at least it's new for him.
Never seen you in a dress that color, no.
Oh, like prom. Dude is 30 years older than your daughter. I think those dirty looks are warranted.
A different perspective led me to what they were actually going for, and that'd be Adam crashing this girl's wedding.
For something so controversial, this is one lackluster song.
That's gotta be what this song's about. And yet, I have an easier time remembering Cold and its basic imagery way more than Mr. Day Ruiner here. And it's because Wait is a passionless song to bridge the gap between two also top 10 performing hits. The only plus it can get is that it's better than What Lovers Do, but I'll forget it by next decade.
Well, silver linings, right?
I'm upset.
Number 4.
I don't practice Santeria.
Oh yeah, Post. You do sublime.
But it ain't no use in turning on your light, babe.
Oh hell, yeah. Good stuff. Now talk about drug dependency ruining a perfectly good relationship.
Everything came second to the band song.
Maybe not so much the last one, but these are examples of Post Malone being his cool self. Laid back and just a fun guy to be around.
Does it translate into his original music? Never.
Damn, I ain't be gone psycho, la mama bella Michael.
Whoa, leave the rest of the psycho for somebody else, guy.
It's been a while since I've heard such a backwards attempt to convey an idea.
Going psycho? More like going mellow.
If Congratulations was called psycho, I'd call it at least a 4 out of 10 success of conveying that feeling. But this is so weak.
Know that I've been with the shits ever since the jet.
This totally banal crap is what makes this number 4 here and Post's worst song. Like, this isn't great, but it was a first attempt. This gets a little better with time. Barely.
Ooh, I fought apart.
At least it's not him bragging more. Alright, fine, it's his thing to brag like this, but you better not pull this shit again.
Damn, I ain't be gone psycho.
No, you're not.
I honestly like better now a little more that it's overshadowing this turd, and now giving it the time is making me more frustrated. Who cares about this great verse from whoever the hell? Who cares about the lyrics? Brag, 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 got it. Psycho is a purposeless dirge that completely wastes your time.
But Post, if you ever want to hang out, just hit me up.
I'm upset.
Number 3.
My number 2 is supposed to be a tie.
And that's why we find ourselves here, at number 3, with a song that's practically identical to the one coming after.
Weird universe we live in, right? Not really. But you know what'll never change in pop music? Change.
Of course, it's a relative term, but for a fluid, ever-evolving market, it's the new faces that keep it fresh.
New face, future one-hit wonder, talentless guy with a god-awful name. Just ask yourself, ladies, was it worth it?
I like me better when I'm with you.
I'd like you better if you kept your high school songwriting to yourself.
Welcome to the big leagues, kid. Your song is worse than your name, which I'll give you credit, was pretty hard to do. Love. Like a foreign porno. Ugh.
It's so perfect. His song is about love.
And I mean love, not love. Check out how smooth this guy is. I like me better
when I'm with you. Here's what I hear. I like me better when I'm with you. I like me better. I like me.
Can a girlfriend make you into a better person? Absolutely. But you would never phrase it from your point of view. You'd say, you make me better, or I like how I feel with you. Not, I like me better. How self-absorbed can you be?
Quite a lot. I like me better is the second finest attempt at shallow flattery in 2018. Again, there was a tiebreaker.
This was heavily calculated. For instance, how utterly stripped down the song is. I like me better when I'm
with you. Missing an instrument or five there, guy?
Not at all. Minimal was the intention. Backing or a band doesn't make for a personal experience. So thanks again, Todd. This is tied for the shittiest, most uselessly frustrating white guy with an acoustic guitar song of the year.
Again, we'll clarify where the split happened at number two.
This song's sole purpose is to get laid. It's generic, skeevy, and air quotes personalized. He put some touches here and there to put that across, like the way he says damn before every chorus.
Damn.
God, is that fake. The only thing this guy loves is the money this'll make him. And for maximum trend writing, one-hit impact, he put the most wretched instrument drop of the year. Nice voice coder clapped in, except that sounded cool 40 years ago. Now it sounds blasty and random. It's a professional kazoo solo. Line starts here, ladies. It's not even trying to be interesting like a real producer. It's two notes with a downward run.
The most agonizing two notes of all time.
And the rest is so frustratingly whatever. It doesn't deserve the existence or time. Congrats, Lauv. You got us to hear your amateur trash. Enjoy your future career of selling insurance. I'm sure you'll do a better job. I'm upset. Number two.
Hey, don't blame Lauv for his success. Blame the guy who kicked the trend off. There, little guy. Your wounds will heal. The bad man will never hurt you again.
Talk about a wigwag. This guy's never touched a guitar before. Apparently you yank the strings as far from the guitar as possible and just fling them back. That's actually how this feat is possible in Pit People, so Lights Down Low has a professional guitar archer.
It was a pretty dangerous studio session.
And no matter where else you go in the song, guitarchery never fucking stops. Soon you'll realize you are the targets of those guitars falling from the sky.
We would call this maximum damage.
Other than that, many of the other decisions were bad. Very bad. Unlike Lauv's minimalist trash, Max throws as much sound in the chorus as possible. His annoying voice, synth blood, crowd noise, jackhammer, raw unmitigated hatred, and the scream of a dying rabbit. Oh wait, that's just Max.
Maybe you should stick to the production, guy. Maybe you should stick to nothing, cause you suck, guy.
By the way, did you wonder why these were almost tied? These videos are virtually identical.
As are their intentions.
Let's get hot and heavy again. And just like the noob before, he too sticks to forgettable generalities to make him as attractive as possible. How attractive? Like a dog trained to say I love you. Tell me again why you love me, pup? Oh, that's right. You can't. And also with the brain of an animal. Moonlight, mood lights, moves like J-Lo. Hi, little guy. Still getting work, huh? Have you
ever sent an I love you? Ever think of doing something else?
He sucks. Max sucks. This shit is bad. Alone, that makes these two songs a tie.
Until that fateful day, I turned on my radio and heard this.
I know this isn't the version that made this shit popular, but it was the extra excessive kind of raw garbage that put it over the top. At least Lauv only released his trash once, but Max attempted shitty modification well after his song was gone. Screw you guys, sorry about your short-lived careers.
And let's not forget those others who tried to drag down 2018 also. I don't care what anybody says, this is another example of bad sampling.
I was the only one who got mad when Santana got lazily thrown into a DJ Khaled song last year. I was also the only person to even mention it. This one is actually easy to pinpoint what makes it not work.
Do you like how there's somebody from 2018 singing next to somebody singing from the mid-20th century?
If crystal clear quality into fuzzy, non-remastered rips doesn't make you angry like me, then fine. But this is a fantastic example of sampling gone lazy.
Or else, this is your Despacito 2. Hooray! Oh, baby.
Take Stay, make it not as good or memorable. Was my number 10 until a tiebreaker split my number 2 into two separate entries.
Mostly number 10 because of Gray. Meet me in the
middle. Zed, let these fuckers go. They made Starving unlistable, and their trashy dog whistles do nothing but bring down your already flimsy songs.
You can get rid of the clock in every song too, bud. You got this tonight. See you again next year. Boy, they have not picked up a guitar in years.
Why is this so shit? That's all I can ask. Why would a professional group choose the most amateur-sounding guitar playing I've ever heard hit mainstream radio? Not really a lot to lock onto with the rest of it, and when I thought about putting it on here... Not too long
ago, I was dancing for dollars. Cardi B is not allowed to have her own songs anymore. Her guest features are the only thing she sounds like she cares about. She's like the anti-Kendrick Lamar. Hey yo,
look like I'm going for a swim. Honk. Honk, honk. Hope that doesn't run through the whole song. That'd fucking suck.
Yep, that's all of them. What a forgettable year. I'm upset.
50,000 on my head is disrespect. Number one. So offended that I had to double check. I need more impassioned terrible in my life. Not this wishy-washy bad first attempt and the continued common shit I get from familiar faces. I wanted something to happen in 2018. If Lights Down Load stayed my number one, I would have been pretty disappointed. It sucks the air out of the planet, but it just doesn't hit like Issues or Honey I'm Good. Hell, 2015 was an infinitely better year for pop music, and I can still say my top three worst songs from that year are worse than boring old Max over here. I missed feeling raw disgust and hatred of really bad songs. It makes me feel, and golly do I like to feel.
It turns out, there was a song here all along that was worse than everything else this year. A song so bad that it would fulfill my bloodlust for bad pop music. It hit my radio once, and I knew what my number one had to be. I still see your shadows in my room. Can't take back the love that I gave you. It's so awful. Finally.
You know, it's times like these where I feel bad for putting the song and video in the background, because this is just repulsive. All of it. The song sounds like the producer did everything he could to sabotage this guy's career before it even started. And this video is hilarious. Listening to my heart instead of my head. Oh wow, more like Giraffe World. But that's not why we're here.
We're here to relish in the worst made song in a long time. I have
these lucid dreams. That bass was definitely a good decision. Overbearing, slurry, and filthy. Whoever mixed this probably sustained a grenade blast and everybody felt bad and didn't correct the concussed guy.
I feel him. Happens all the time. Oh shit!
I'd say in the scheme of things, it's the worst mixed bass I've ever heard. It never stops giving me chills, and it will never stop being awful.
But that was a strategy, because the production should match the quality of the leading man.
This guy is bad. Lyrics, performance, everything. He's got the charisma of a stone you find in your shoe.
Ugh.
Can't take back the love that I gave you.
Okay, so he's mad.
It's to the point why I love and I hate you.
Okay, so he's confused.
You found another one, but I am the better one.
Okay, he's a dick. He just jumps around with these lyrics. He talks about replacing her just to say he can't, just to say he won't let her go without forgetting him, blah, blah, blah.
I'm getting the high school poetry vibe here. And high school word association.
You were made out of plastic, fake.
If you don't think your audience is gonna get your half-baked metaphor, don't use it.
I gave you my heart and you made heartbreak.
Is that like a dish? Heartbreak? A delicacy?
You made my heart break.
Oh, you could have specified that. Instead of using poor grammar that doesn't fit, you could have just said that.
You made my heart break again.
I know. You just said it 6 times, jackass.
Look, I'm sorry about your failed relationship, but your emotions are overshadowed by your utterly terrible song.
You left me falling in.
Oh, I get it now. He had 30 minutes to make the whole song. That explains why these verses use an almost, but not really, quarter note triplet rhythm. It's the first thing that came to his head.
I know it's all in my head.
Not anymore. Now we're stuck with it forever.
Forever indeed. Apparently the popular conscious deemed this worthy of months of top 10 limelight. Instead of being like one of those songs that eats up slots on Billboard and I never hear it, this one made it to radio because fuck our ears, right? Lucid Dreams is a song that gets nothing right and deserves to be up there with one of the worst songs of all time.
I have these lucid dreams where I can't move a thing.
That's not what a lucid dream is, moron.
If you want a good song called Lucid Dreams, Franz Ferdinand made a 7.5-minute ode to experiencing the phenomenon in music. There. Now that other song has no purpose at all.
Yay, no more bad.
What's your list? Slap it underneath. Don't forget, my music taste is shit. Or save that for my best list. That's a great burn, dude.
If I can even do a best list, I'm out of notebook.
Last year. So far. Expect best next. Goodbye.